Today we're actually going to go ahead and start notes, start looking through some of the material. We're going to start with chapter one, which is a matter of energy, some significant figures, and some basic stuff. So most of this is going to be a review for you. Now the way that I usually give notes, usually I'm going to give notes on the ORED, and I'm going to write them out by hand, and as I write them out, I'll show you different things, I'll talk about different things, explain things. I expect you to write the notes out also, okay? So you're going to want to have a notebook so you can write your notes out. I am not going to post the notes, and this is why I do not post the handwritten notes afterwards. What I found last year is people were not watching the lecture and only looking at the notes, and students were having a hard time. And they were having a hard time because they didn't understand what they were reading on the notes. You really have to watch the lecture. So, please write the notes out by hand as I do that. So, let's go ahead and get started. And we are going to be working with our first notes. So, here we go. The question is, where should we start? And we're going to start with just a basic definition of chemistry. So chemistry, we're going to define as the study of matter its properties and the changes it undergoes. So basically, when we're talking about chemistry, we're talking about what matter is, what makes it up, what are its properties, and how we can change it, or how it goes through different changes. And for a lot of the beginning part of the year, we're going to talk a lot about what matter is. Okay? And then eventually, once we get into the second semester, we'll talk a lot about what changes it goes under, or it goes through. Now, what is matter? Matter is anything that has mass and takes up space. Has mass and takes up space. So, for example, this rock would be a piece of matter, and you would define it as matter because it could take its mass, use a triple beam balance or an electronic balance and get its mass. Okay, so it's made up of stuff, and it has a definite volume, so it takes up space. Now, the question is everything matter? The answer is no. Okay, for example, energy is not matter. Okay, so if we look at light, okay, it doesn't have any mass. Okay, it doesn't really take up space, but it is something that affects different substances. So not everything is matter. And this is also changing, so we're discovering a lot of other things. There's something called dark matter, or we think there's something called dark matter, and it doesn't fit with the rules of regular matter. We don't really understand what dark matter is yet. So there are a lot of other things out there that are part of the universe, but are not considered to be matter. And we're going to deal with this true sense of matter in this class. Now, we need to be able to classify matter. So there are different types of matter. And the first one we'll talk about are our mixtures. And a mixture is a combination of two or more substances in which each retains its own chemical identity. When we're talking about mixtures, these can be separated physically. So these can be separated physically. So we're going to use physical properties to separate them. And we'll talk about those in a minute. So we'll use those physical properties to separate them. Now, if you look around wherever you are right now, most of the matter that you're looking at is going to be a mixture. So matter is mostly in this form. Most matter is in mixture form. So now we have two types of mixtures. We have homogeneous. These are uniform throughout the sample. In other words, you cannot see the different parts. So if we break down homogeneous, okay, homo means same. Now, another name for a homogeneous mixture is a solution. These are solutions. Now realize when we're talking about solutions, you can have solutions in all different phases. They can be solids, liquids, and gases. So homogeneous mixtures are uniform throughout. And let me show you one. Okay, so this is a homogeneous mixture. This is just food coloring, water. So when we look at this, no matter where you look, it's the same. Okay, so it's the same over here as it is over here. Okay, the physical properties throughout this whole substance are always the same. This is also considered to be a solution. So another example of a homogeneous mixture would be brass. Brass is a mixture of metals, and no matter where you look at that mixture of that metal, it is the same. So it would be a homogeneous solution. Our second type of mixture is a heterogeneous mixture. See the different parts. You can see the different parts. And I have one here. So let's look at this. Let's go back to our rock. We know that this is matter because it takes up space and has mass. But if we look closely at it, okay, this is definitely a mixture. And it is a heterogeneous mixture, and I know it's a heterogeneous mixture because I can actually see different parts of the mixture. So here I have a lot of black, there's some pink over here, there's actually some white in there. So we can see the different parts of this. So there are different physical characteristics in different parts of the mixture. So this would be a heterogeneous mixture. Alright, so our mixtures are our first type of matter. The second type of matter are our pure substances. And the first pure substance are the elements. And we define an element as a substance that cannot be decomposed into a simpler substance. Now, where do we find the list of the elements? Well, this is a periodic table. So on the periodic table, we now know that there are, we have 118 known elements. So these are the basis of matter. Okay, this is what all matter is built from. Now, if you noticed last class in homework, I asked you to start going back through and learning some of the elements. It's going to be real important that you know names and symbols for some of them. I don't want you to know all of them. I think I said 1 through 54, and then I gave you a list of a few other ones that you should know. And what I mean by that is make sure that you're learning names and symbols. Okay? I'm going to start talking in symbols and writing in these chemical symbols, and you really need to know what I'm talking about. So I'm not going to test you or quiz you on that. Well, actually, it could be on a test, but make sure you work through those. Okay? Now, I put your periodic table on Google Classroom, okay, and if you take a look at it, it's pretty bare. All right, so make sure you print out a copy of that periodic table so you have it, so you can start working on that and looking through those different things. Now, if you don't have the names, they are in the textbook. You can find a list of all those elements and names. Oh, example of an element. And I have one, here's one right here. So this is a pure substance. I have a single element. This is sulfur. Okay, so this is elemental sulfur. It would be considered a pure compound. So if I have one element, it's a pure substance. Our second pure substance are our compounds. And these are substances that can be chemically separated. Into two or more elements. You're probably the most famous compound of them, well, besides water, I guess is the most famous, but this is sodium chloride, NaCl. All right, so this is a single compound of sodium atoms and chlorine atoms bonded together to form a single molecule. So this is sodium chloride. Now, to separate a compound, you have to do some sort of chemical reaction to separate them. They cannot be separated physically. This is another example of a compound. This is copper 2 sulfate. To separate this, we would have to do a chemical reaction of some sort and separate it into the copper and the sulfate ions. Okay, so this is another example of a pure substance. Now, you may be asked to classify matter. And it really is a little chart. Okay, so first you always start with, is it matter? And if the answer takes up space and has mass, if it's matter, then we can actually classify it. Once we know that it's matter, the first thing you're going to ask yourself, is it uniform? If the answer is no, well, there's only one substance it can be. It's got to be a heterogeneous mixture. If the answer is yes, that means it's the same throughout. Okay? That tells us that it's homogeneous. That doesn't mean that it's a mixture, because if you have a single compound that's also homogeneous, if you look at this guy, okay, no matter where you look, it's the same. If you look at the element of sulfur, no matter where you look, it's the same. If we look at this solution right here, no matter where we look, it's the same. Right, so if it's homogeneous, or if it's uniform, it's homogeneous, then we've got to figure out what type of matter it is from there. So once you know this, we want to know, can it be separated by physical means? Can it be separated by physical means? If the answer is yes, that tells us that it's a homogeneous mixture. Remember, mixtures are separated physically. If the answer is no, it cannot be separated physically. That tells us that it's a pure substance. Once we know that it's a pure substance, we're going to say, hey, can it be decomposed chemically? Can it be decomposed chemically? If the answer is no, it's an element. If the answer is yes, it is a compound. So this is just a nice little easy chart for you to help you classify matter. And you can just go through the steps. So let's try one, just for fun. Let's look at this guy. So the first thing you want to know is this matter, and the answer is yes, it takes up space and has mass. It takes up space and has mass. The first thing you're going to say to yourself, is this uniform? Okay, and if you look closely, you can see different layers, okay? There's pebbles up here, and then there's little sand and stuff in here, so this is not uniform. So this has to be a heterogeneous mixture. I want to show you this because it's fun. If we were to classify it again, it is matter, again, it takes up space and has mass. Is it uniform? Again, the answer is no. Okay, so we got layers here. So this is, again, a heterogeneous mixture. How about this? Sorry. So what's in my beaker? Well, big gases have mass, and they take up space. And so is the gas that's in here uniform? Answer is yes, no matter where we look in that beaker, it's definitely uniform. This is over here on the other side, so this is homogeneous. Now my question is, can we physically separate the parts of this mixture? Now what's in air? Well, we have oxygen and carbon dioxide and mostly nitrogen, right? So there are different gases, okay? There are different gases in here. They can be separated physically. We can separate them by mass. So we can physically separate these different elements. So this has to be, a a homogeneous mixture. And so this is just a couple of examples of how to use the chert. And that's kind of a lie, because there are things that make up atoms. We won't really talk about quarks and mesons and gluons and things like that very much. Right? But for our purposes, an atom is the smallest piece of matter. And these are what form our elements and compounds. Now let's talk about the difference between an atom and a molecule. So when we're talking about a molecule, we're talking about two or more atoms joined together in a specific shape. So a molecule, we have to have at least two atoms, and they have to be bonded together in a specific state. So let's say that we have a hydrogen molecule. As soon as I say molecule, we're talking about diatomic hydrogen. Two hydrogen atoms bonded together, okay, and they're in a linear shape. This right here is a hydrogen molecule. If I just look at one atom of hydrogen, if I only have one atom of hydrogen, it wouldn't be considered a molecule. Okay, so, for example, hydrogen is an example, but diatomic, they always come in pairs, but most molecules are not. You can have a single atom of neon. This would not be a molecule. It's a single atom. H2O. It's a molecule. Oops. It's a molecule. It's got a bent shape. And so this would be a molecule. So hopefully that clears up a little bit what the difference is between a molecule and an atom. This should really all be review, guys. I know it's a little tedious, but we have to get through some of these just to make sure you understand some of these basics. So let's make another definition. Let's talk about physical versus chemical. physical properties. These are observed properties. Of matter. And by that I mean they can be measured. Or identified without changing the substance. And physical properties include stuff like color, density, shape, mass, and those kind of things. So for example, if we looked at a piece of paper, and I want to know some of its physical characteristics, you know, it's white, it's thin, it's in the shape of a rectangle, okay, we can measure its mass, and we don't need to change this piece of paper to figure out those physical properties. In contrast, we can talk about chemical properties. And a chemical property is the way a substance reacts or changes with another substance. And in reality, it has to be with another substance. It could be just with the addition of energy. Let's write that. Or with the addition of energy. Okay, so when we're talking about chemical properties, to come up with a chemical property, you are actually destroying that substance. We're changing it into something else. Okay, so for an example, a chemical property of paper is it's combustible. Now, what does that mean? Well, when we combust something or burn something, we're actually adding oxygen. That's what we're doing. Energy is released. So a chemical property of this paper would be the paper reacts with oxygen to produce carbon dioxide, water, and energy. That would be an example of a chemical property of paper. And you can always just use that simple phrase, the substance reacts with something to produce something else, and that will give us its chemical property. Here we go. Ready? I'll make one up just for fun. Okay. Paper reacts with hydrochloric acid to produce sulfur dioxide and magnesium. Now, that is not a true statement, but if it was, that would be a chemical property of paper. Now, we'll do lots of chemical changes, right? But it's always something reacts with something to something else. So while we're here, let's talk about physical change and chemical change. Physical change. So when we're talking about physical change, the physical appearance changes, but not the composition. physical appearance changes, but not the composition. In other words, it's the same substance before and after the change. How can I physically change this piece of paper? You fold it. To you right now, it looks like the actual mass has been cut in half. But it hasn't. Okay, it's the same exact thing as it was, it's just paper. And I can tear it. Okay, it's still just paper. I haven't changed it at all. Okay? I could write on it, anything like that. Okay, these are physical changes. Some other physical changes. Phase change is a physical change. If I take an ice cube and I let it melt, then that's a physical change. The ice cube is just solid H2O. Okay? That H2O is just in a different phase of matter when it's melted. If I boil it off and make it a gas, it